if that train had caught my bag, I would have been gone with the train. So that's opened my eyes. And that's not happened in years.
Don't do this at home.
No,
kids,
do not. I mean? That's what I was just going to say. Killer podcast.
KellerKellerOfficial.com. You need the Kellervision app. 24/7 mini documentaries, podcasts, live shows, DJ live streams, top fives, subscription packages, plus products for all your podcasts and street culture sports. Download it from the App Store for free today.
Instagram UK Frontline.
Beatbox created.
Killer Keller.
And we're here to talk about world music and street culture.
Killer Keller podcast.
You ready?
Yeah, mate, when you are.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Killer Keller podcast. And what a wonderful first day it is, whatever day, whatever time you're tuning in. Big shout out to graffitikings.co.uk. Hold tight to Reggie's, you know, sharing is caring. Kellervision, also in effect in the form of an app, free download. Do not sleep on that. I repeat, do not sleep on that, repeat. We've got an OG in the house. And I say an OG because for many years, I've seen this gentleman in various guises, mostly street actually, but without question, a name that you're going to remember, particularly from the southeast region of the UK. He goes by the name of Vods. How are you, my
Easy.
Brother?
All good.
Wow. And
it's been a long time, so. Yeah.
It has been a long time. And
we'll have it out of the way today.
He's like, I'm coming, he's clocked in, he's got the tab, he's clocked in. bro, it's actually strangely ironic that we connect like this because throughout my whole growing up, and coming into London and getting familiarised with the scene, your name just was always there. It was always there. There was a presence that you had. Do you feel me?
It was a daily thing. When we started, it was literally a 24-hour 365. Mm. It was daytime, you're out, you're getting your food, you're getting your paint, you're getting your this, you're getting getting everything that you could possibly need and want. And then over night time, we was painting. Mm. God knows how we'd be walking around the next day. We must have been looking like zombies or technicoloured zombies, you know what I mean? But you was back out there on the same thing. You go home, you have a wash, bang, same thing. And that went on for years.
Mostly around the southeast region, wasn't it?
Just London, basically. More or less just London. Yeah. A couple of coastal places. Yeah, just wherever we went. We didn't say, oh, we're going to go everywhere. We just ripped where we went.
Mm. You're admired by a lot of writers. When I tell people that you're coming on, they were like, oh, Wicked, yeah, he's coming on, he's fucking... It seems to me that you're quite the glue to a lot of people's banter and good times.
To be straight, there's a lot of people out there that, in the writing world, they're going around, they're mugging people, they're doing this, they're doing that. I'm not one of them people. Mm. We either get on or we don't. Mm. And I find with a lot of people, we just get on, unless they're a total mug or something, and I don't like them, because I ain't got a problem in telling someone that. Mm. If I don't like them, then I won't talk to you.
Genuine bloke.
It's straight up. I'm not going to, hide from it.
Yeah.
It is what it is.
When did it begin? When did it all start for you, brother?
It's all Charles' fault, to be honest with you.
Of course it is.
Yeah, all Charles' fault.
Hold tight, Charles.
And Speak, rest in peace.
Rest in peace, all right.
Just from the school days, really. I can remember Char writing, like...
How old were you at the time?
At the time, probably about 14, 15. Something like that. And basically, we used to take the piss out of Char, saying, you write on the wall and it gets cleaned off, and all of that, taking the right piss out of him.
Okay.
And then, like, Ed White, madness, 30 mil tags in the school corridors, like, Mr. Duncan's a cunt, and things like this. And we was just like...
So you went to the same school together?
Yeah, so we was like, do you know what? We need to get on this, you know. I mean, this is like we see him at Wandsworth Roundabout one time.
Yeah.
And for some reason, we ended up going in B&Q with him. We nicked up some paint, and then we're spraying in the roundabout. And then from that moment, it was like we're on this. And that was like me, Pies at that point. So
you and Pies. What caught your attention to it? What was the appeal? Because like you say, it was by the sounds of it, it was
to be straight media. With you. At that point, it was just plain, simple vandalism, the buzz of it.
Right.
It was an outlet.
Right.
And then as time goes on, obviously you think, oh, I want to get good, I want to get better. But then at the same time, you've got to be sitting there sketching and things and coming up with new ideas. Otherwise, you're just copying someone else, which, to be straight, it all evolves from something.
It does all.
So it's all similar in a way.
It's interesting you say that, because
it's hard to change a letter, let's say, for example.
Did you say there was flavours for the day, you know, back then? Because we're talking in retrospect right here. Man's an OG, you know what I mean? He's got a family as well, you know, you're looking after yourself and you're doing well with yourself.
Yeah, much better than I used to.
For sure.
Graff was life then, but now it's still there, don't get me wrong. It's a big part, but there's other things now, you know, children. Yeah. Having work, keeping a roof over your head. Back then, you didn't really give a shit. You'd sleep on your mate's sofa.
Yeah.
You'd sleep on your mate's floor. Furthermore, sleep in the police station. You didn't give a shit.
You didn't care. It wasn't
didn't really give a damn.
Just going back to what I was saying, actually, before I interjected, but there was a flavour of the day when it came to tags and letters and things. As an onlooker through the mid to late 90s into the noughties, there definitely was a style, a real... push on a particular style of London graff, wasn't there?
Yeah, definitely, definitely. A lot of people are coming out with similar stuff, and it basically got put down, noted down as, that's London style.
Mm.
So we're all part of that, growing up in that time. We're all, it evolved to what it is.
I
can't say how it happened, it just happened.
Yeah.
It's just your influences.
Yeah.
Seeing certain things and going, oh, I might have a go at trying something similar to that, and then it just gets better and better. Or you do say it and it's worse and you think, screw that up and throw it away. But what you might not like, someone else does.
Because there is a bovine that watch.
Yeah, there's, a lot of people go, oh, that is crap. They go, yeah, I fucking love it. And it's like, well, that's just not what I wanted to achieve.
Mm-hmm. When I first started doing this podcast, I didn't realise there were so many people like me that were observers. And we're just like taken aback by the industriousness of how other artists
have moved on.
Yeah, and how it moves.
It's a revolution, isn't it, basically?
It's a revolution.
It's like, you go back 10, 15, 20 years ago, we're vandals, da da da. You should get hold of them, string them up, throw the book at them. Now it's more acceptable.
Mm.
Probably, and then you get people, you've got the street artists and whatnot.
Yeah.
And say 10 years ago, I wouldn't be here doing this because that's just totally against what I believe.
Yeah, yeah. I often think that.
Because of all these street artists and whatnot, and they're getting their bit of credit for they've just jumped in.
Yeah.
It's like, hold on a minute.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm here, to put what we've done to get... You wouldn't be having all this street art if it weren't for us doing our bits.
I could not agree more.
It's
super important.
We made it evolve to this, and it is what it is today because
people paying dues.
I'm probably only like third generation or something. There's other generations before me.
Who were your influences? Who were your influences at that time?
One of the first trains I can remember seeing was a soup train at West Brompton, top to bottom. And we used to always be in Wimbledon Park fishing. Yeah. Right, we used to sneak in there over night time, do a bit of fishing.
Because you like a bit of fishing, don't you?
Yeah, the first trains in the morning, it was always pieced up. And again, it was something like, I want to do that.
Yeah.
And you don't really see it no more.
Yeah.
Not in that on that levels anyway.
Yeah.
But when we were younger, you never really... It was always there, but you never saw it because you was like running about doing what you're doing.
Mm.
It's an influence. Mm. Now it's not there so much, so you ain't got so many people doing it.
Mm.
Obviously, everywhere you went, there was tags.
Mm.
Everywhere.
Mm.
So, you just get tied into it.
And you see those certain names and things, and they become pen pals.
Buried in your head, this sort of thing. Yeah, it's like, oh, I want to meet that person.
What's it like when you meet the people that you were initially pen pals to or you'd seen and you were influenced by? What was it like when you thought, fuck, I'm actually with this person?
To be straight, a few times, it's like, well, I would have never expected this. I've known you for fucking months and I didn't even know.
Yeah.
It's like, well, we get on, but I've never asked you what you write.
That's mad.
It's because you're just talking and being... I don't need to say, oh, what do you write if I fucking get on with you? And you just talk, innit?
You don't really think
it. Have a beer, have a smoke. You don't go, oh, well, what's your tag then?
Mm.
It's... that comes second. You
what's
know
it
what
like?
I mean?
What's it like being of that age and having all that happening? Because these are informative years, but then all of a sudden it's almost like smelling each other's scent. Where it's like, all right, well, should we do it then? Should we go and do it? What was it like when you first connect in that level? Is it like an unwritten kind of code of conduct that suddenly changes?
You don't even have to say words. I could just be with certain people and just look at them. And I ain't even open my mouth, but they know what I'm saying.
Really?
And then it just happens. Whoa. What we want to do happens. It's like me and Nate, we all always had this... a lot of people didn't want to go yard with us because our attitude was... He who hesitates masturbates, which basically means don't be a wanker and crack on. Mm. Yeah. After, if you stand there, you see a security, I'm not doing that, you get all pranked. If you just run in there and do it, the security man can bust a call now and what, fuck off. Really? Yeah, it's been done now.
It's funny when you think back that time, because like with writing and graph now, you'll have those same people, bovine, will have the same experiences as that, but round the corner, there'll be a whole production team building a massive graffiti wall for gentrification, you know what I mean? It's actually sending loads of different messages out there, isn't it?
It's very mixed, because you'll go to an event, let's say, for example, back in the day, Unity.
Yeah, Unity.
Down in Fulham, yeah? Everyone will be painting, but by the time everyone leaves, everyone's painting the streets. So you've made a legal event to whatever, bring it up sort of thing, but then the area's getting smashed. Yeah. So
it's hard to discipline, hand in hand, isn't it? Yeah, it's so hard to discipline. Why do you think
it is? Because I think it's, to be straight with you, being older now, I think if they give you somewhere to paint and you look after it, they're going to always allow you to paint there.
Yeah.
Right? But our views of graffiti, that isn't sort of doing graffiti.
It's a different thing.
It's about the dare. It's about the rush. It's about the... When I first think... If you said graffiti to me when I was a teenager, yeah, I'm thinking of the underground straight away. Mm. I'm not thinking of some wall on the side of a place where you're allowed to do it. Mm. I'm thinking dirty tunnels, fucking paint bogeys, you know what I mean? Barbed wire, lasers, fucking rats. Yeah, you know what I mean? Not this nice, clean environment. You've got 3 hours to paint a wall.
Put the rats alone, I'd be like... But you're right, I see a lot of rats back then, wouldn't you? Like the...
You're never more than a metre away from one eye.
Generally, yeah. That's right, yeah. Truth. I can imagine. Look, this is the thing. What is it that makes a writer, particularly at that age, go ham? Is it an emotional charge? Is it something... Is there an upset that triggers that, do you think?
I think we all used it as an outlet, myself. We all had a problem in some way, whatever it may be. It could be anything. It was just a get-out. It's like, you know, what does a general teenager do these days? Right? They discover a bit of drugs, they discover a bit of alcohol. Yeah. Next thing you know, they're on the floor being sick, all in their hair.
Can't do anything right, can they?
No. But we was, you know, premeditative planning things. You know, we've grown from it. Mm. Yeah, we've got skills from it, you know.
You've built into adults with skills.
Even patience and all sort of like, just to sit there and watch the security man, what's he up to? And you're keeping, you know, I don't know, it almost brings a bit of order to your life rather than just running around scatty doing stupidness.
Okay, right.
It brings a little bit of...
Yeah, like elaborate on that a bit more. What order is in? Give me... Well, things how it's affected you.
It would start with a phone call, say, and then we'd go round and have a look, what's what, and yeah. So there was a name to it. We weren't just, like I said, running around being scatty teenagers. We had a reason, a means.
And how much has that influenced you as you've got older? So what things that do you put into place now that you could say, you know what, I'll take cues from that because I've learned that?
Pretty much everything, to be honest. Really? You've got to think about everything. Even the smallest detail can make a big difference. Mm. You know, like the domino effect.
Yeah.
If you're going to go and do a hot move and you've gone in the shop without being covered up and they look back on you, you're caught from that little detail. Mm. So, you know, or you're walking down the high, like, why do that? Park on the back street.
Yeah.
You've got to put these things in measure. The smallest detail can be the biggest downfall.
From a lifestyle point of view, what what do you think, you know, just on a day-to-day, how has it helped you? How has the influence of Graff helped you, do you reckon?
It has. I think it's an eye to detail. Mm-hmm. I think in the end, you know, I go to work, I see certain things, and I can look at it. I almost think I'm a bit OCD. You come in my house at certain point times, it's an absolute state. But when I start straightening stuff out, if it's a little bit, isn't it? So it's an eye to detail. Everything I do, I try and do well. Mm. And I think that comes from the Graff thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, it really does, I think.
That's crazy. I've never heard it like that.
You know, you've got to try and be good at everything you do.
Yeah. And I think that is the challenge that a lot of people...
I think it's being meticulous.
Meticulous.
It's being good at what you do. And, you know, do it once, do it well.
Mm.
And, yeah, move on from that.
Inspiring stuff, brother. I've never heard it said like that. I've never heard it put in that context, actually.
Again, it's evolution. It all boils down to it's just moving on, moving on, moving on. Next year, it'll be a different thing.
Mm.
Furthermore, when all of this COVID stuff's done and they've got all these new cameras and that, is it still going to be happening? There's always going to be that underground scene.
There is always going to be. Yeah, yeah. It's mad.
It might come full circle. The street art will disappear and the fucking stuff will come back.
That becomes the front of it. I was only talking about this the other day to a friend of mine. I can't remember what, but, you know, nowadays, like, with music, publishing is crazy. You can't even play a song on Facebook without it being taken down. Is there an underworld for that? Is there an underworld?
Because they're looking at the words saying something different than what it actually is. Well, why don't they let people have their own opinion and understand it how their brain understands it?
Yeah.
Because anything can mean anything to someone. They could go, ooh, that means, like, well, it doesn't mean that, you know what I mean? Furthermore, they've been doing it for years, haven't they? Like Oasis and all of that. They're talking about drugs and all of that sort of shit. Well, they're number one and they've earned millions and da, da, da. So
people have weakened, haven't they? They're fucking snowflakey, innit?
It's, yeah, they've become moaners.
Yeah.
Yeah, moaners. Oh, if I don't like it, I'm going to say something. Like, why don't you just let people
be?
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Like,
it's
why don't you let people, you know, oh, I'm going to sue you. I'm going to sue, like...
The fuck?
When I heard my old man used to say, he used to go, oh, what, do you think this is the America or something?
Well, yeah, that was the classic.
You see now, it's happening, isn't it?
Hold tight to the mum and dad crew, you know who you are.
Yeah, big
you know
ups.
They do that.
Yeah. But yeah, it's... That never used to happen before.
Uh-huh.
And now it has. And that's what they're becoming moaners.
Yeah.
Next door's making noise. Oh, I'm on the phone. It's like...
Oh, mate, don't. Now that it's a COVID thing, they'll call up and rat on you just for having more than one person in the house.
Yeah, it's...
And you get fined.
Fucking what? Nah, it's all that's... Well, I'm not saying it's 100% rubbish, but it's all there for a reason.
Yeah.
It's all happening for a reason.
Divide and conquer, that's what I'm saying.
It's all to take people over, that's my opinion anyway.
Yeah.
All your Rockefellers and all of that, yeah.
It goes deeper than we'd ever know, innit?
Yeah, it goes further. It goes further. There's so many things you can say, but it all seems to be happening at the same time, and that's, I believe, there's a reason.
For real?
It's there's a reason.
I agree.
So simple.
Yeah, V, man, do you reckon at face value when people see Graff, do you think that there has been a change of tide and an attention to almost sanitised now in a lot of respects?
I think I touched on that just a minute ago. When
hasn't it?
Someone's got a nice clean wall, they've got 3 hours to paint it, they're not in no dusty tunnel with a rat. It's become clean.
Mm.
Like I said, when we thought about it, you think of the underground, the dirt, the grime, the...
Yeah.
Hear that noise there, it's like...
Let's see, screeching,
you know what I mean? It's...
We're here inside the tunnels right now. See, this ain't no... You know what I mean? We are live and direct Central London, baby. You know,
hear that screeching round the bend. It sounds lovely, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It don't sound nice when it's right next to you, though. But, yeah.
Explain to me that. What's the most, you know, haunting moment of being in those situations? I mean, is the screech that kind of...
It's a couple of years ago now. I was out with Pies and Tays.
Mm.
And we was doing an early reach by London Bridge ends, because there was track workers there every night.
Mm-hmm.
So we went on the early. Anyway, it was only a little wall up to say, you know, sort of cheek height. So you're down painting, and it was on a bend. And I've lifted my head up, and I've seen this train coming round the bend. So I've told them, like, the fucking train's there. So we've all ducked in our little alcove bit. Anyway, I still had my bag on my back.
Mm.
After the train's passed, Pies was like, come here now. I was like, what? He said, your bag, like, the train was that close to your bag. So I was like, no, I want to go, mate. I'm not even doing this now. And he was like, well, you're going to be on full now. We'll carry on. So we carried on and done our pieces. And sure enough, the trackies come along and we got a little bit of a dust is out of there. But if that train had caught my bag, I would have been gone with the train. So that's opened my eyes. And that's not happened in years.
Don't do this at home.
No,
kids,
do not. What I mean? That's what I was just going to say. Yeah. You got to be safe now. The trains are quieter.
Yeah.
They're making them bigger. They're taking up a lot more room.
Mm.
Don't get caught out. So, you know, do not get caught out.
There you go.
Right, well, look, RIP, all the boys, you know, like yeah. K-Bag, Lover.
Yeah.
All them boys there.
Yeah.
All right, Dyer didn't get hit by a train, but RIP, yeah. Dyer. That's just too many.
It's just too many,
missed
man.
Anyone,
it's just too many, yeah. bro. Too many.
It's just big up all the fallen soldiers.
Yeah, all the fallen soldiers.
We're going to keep your name going still.
Yeah, that's
you
right.
Know? And
that's right.
That's another thing about Graff. You'll be gone, but you're still there.
Yeah. See that jazz? It's got a jazz vibe to it where people, they want to know about the history. They want to know back in the day. They want to know who the key people are. They want to know. It's like a rabbit hole of just...
It can carry on and on and on and on and on and on and on. Yeah, of course. On and on. Yeah, of course. How are you going to be forgotten? That's when it's totally wiped out and no one's got a memory of it and then it disappears. Well, that's not going to happen, surely.
Can't.
Like, well, I think they're aiming to do something like that, but yeah.
Well, as you say, you know, what's the forecast? No one knows, and that's the most... disheartening, uncertain feeling to where we're at right now, isn't it, in the start of the year?
Do you know what? I sit in my room in my four walls daily and think, what's it coming to?
Yeah.
And I ain't got no answer. Yeah. So to be honest, I reckon you should just make the best of what you've got now because things are going to change.
Mm.
A lot of people think things are going to go back to normal. No way.
Not.
That is not going to happen because this is in people's head now.
Got to find another thing to do now.
Yeah, this is here now.
Yeah.
So don't think we're going back to normal because it ain't going to happen. This is the digital age now.
Yeah.
This is where it's going.
Yeah.
That's my thoughts on it anyway. Mm.
Talking of which, actually, you I see on your page you've got some mad colour pieces that you've been, you know, I've seen that you've been putting up for sale and stuff. The Vods ones, they look sick, man.
I can't think of what one's there.
There's this one, it's green. I can show you. You know the one I'm talking about?
Green.
You've just been doing some like...
I've been doing them for a while now, so... Yeah.
They're looking good.
What, there was a Vods thing in green?
Yeah.
See, I can't
You use it as your status as well.
Oh, that thing, yeah, that's just a little drawing on a bit of paper and I took a photo of it.
How often do you do them? Because they're... I mean, it just takes my nostalgia back.
It depends on mood. You know, you could dash a bit of paper in front of me now, I'll start and I can't be bothered. But then if I'm in the mood, I'll sit there all night long. Next thing you know, you look at the clock, you think, fuck me, it's 5 a.m, I need to go to sleep, I've got work.
Those are the best creative moments.
Or you get so far into it, you're just about going to finish it and you colour in the wrong bit. You're like, that ain't even a shadow. What? And you have to screw it up and you start fucking again. And it's, you could sit there for hours, all night long doing it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Especially if you've got the right stuff to be doing it. Obviously, if you've got shit pens now, you're going to think, oh, fuck that.
Yeah. Do you ever miss the golden era?
Every time, every day.
Yeah?
Yeah. Back at, you know, no one had a mobile phone. You used to have to meet at Wimbledon 2 o'clock. If you weren't there, that's it.
Mm.
You come back at 6 and you might bump into someone,
Mm.
And you just go out on the rays and then have a night time out painting. That's how it was.
And again, timekeeping, an essential part of, you know, the adult experience.
No, you get lost in it, especially painting.
Really?
You'll be thinking, oh, we've got an hour to paint. Next thing you know, you've been in there 3 hours.
Wow.
And the place is smashed to smithereens and there ain't no one in sight. And you're like, pfft. I can remember one time, I think it was in Golders Green, but we painted the first train and he was going across the front. And we all had bets on how many trains he was going to get anyway. He only got about the fifth train and the geezer come chasing him. But, we all had, how far do you think he's going to get, you know what I mean?
Oh, my God.
And it didn't take long. I think it was snowing that day as well. That was in the daytime as well. That was a good day.
Wow. How often were those moments to remember? There's certain elements of the scene that still thrive on that. It's like you say, times are ever moving on.
It's about your responsibilities as well.
You reckon?
Yeah, of course. I don't want to go to prison, no. I've got things all right at the moment. I've got a roof over my head. I'm working.
Oh, as you get older sort of thing.
So, yeah, of course. When you was younger, I don't really care. I can make all that up sort of thing. Now, what if I was to go to jail now? What? So I'm going to come out of jail. I ain't seen my kid.
Mm.
Yeah, I ain't got a job. I ain't got a roof on my head. What? Where's that got me?
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely nowhere.
Does the responsibilities help?
What, to stop?
Yeah.
No, I'll never stop.
Okay, but from a...
Never.
No, but I mean, I'm talking about, like...
It makes you think about what you're going to do.
Yeah.
Which, to be straight, I've never been nicked in a yard. You can bet your life if you was going to go and act like that now, it'd be all over you. You could bet your life on it.
Yeah.
So...
To the point it's not actually
you have
worth.
To think, nah, hold on a minute. If we're going to do this, we're going to do it stealth.
Yeah.
We're going to, you know, Mission Impossible this, you know what I mean?
A lot of people like that aspect of it, the Mission Impossible, the invisible.
That's how it all started, and then it turned into not giving a that because yeah. Like I said, you'd plan things, and you'd go and do these planned things, and they don't unfold. It's because you've planned it, you've got high expectations. I say I've never been nicked in the yard. We got nicked at Highgate, I think, in about 2,000 times.
Right.
No one got charged with it. There was like 8 of us. They raided everyone, they got pens and that, but they never got no tags, they never got no photos, no further action to us.
Wow.
And, yeah, we smashed it that night.
Wow.
But, yeah, we got nicked on the station because some geezer had knocked a cab. When the police turned up, obviously we was there, and our top to bottoms are rolling past us while we were getting nicked.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, live it is.
Mm-mm.
Another 30 seconds, we would have been on the train and bye.
Mm-mm. I always find you graph writers really interesting. Big up my boy Gusto, actually, because I remember this story. I think I probably told this story before, but I remember getting on at Crawley on my way to London, and I bump into Gus. And I'm like, oh, gee, what's good? And he's like, yeah, cool. And he's sitting there in front of me. And he says to me, you got a ticket? And I was like, oh, yeah. Yeah, I've got a ticket because I'm law abiding.
Yeah.
And I was like, have you? And he goes, no. And he said it because he saw the ticket man coming. Right, and I shit you not, right?
I walked past it.
Yeah, he kind of waved it. And he sat down next to me as if, like, I've been with him the whole time, kind of, that kind of
get
vibe.
On. Yeah.
Anyway, ticket man comes along and goes, you got a ticket? Ticket man to me. Got your ticket? And I'm like, yeah. So I pull out a ticket, hand it over. He looks at it, cool. And I swear to God, the guard turns around to Gus, looks at him. Gus does this Ben Kenobi Jedi mind trick move. He pulls his shirt down, looking at it, looks up like that, nods at him. The geezer doesn't even think twice and he just walks away.
Off, yeah, because he didn't know what to say, innit? Yeah. He caught him by surprise.
Yeah. And I just was forever, I was just like, yeah, man, you writers, dude, you operate on a different wavelength.
It's different. It's different. What people would be, oh shit, there's a ticket, man. Oh, they were shitting us.
Yeah.
So I ain't got a ticket.
Yeah.
Half the time they just say, all right, sit there, be quiet, and off they go.
Yeah.
You're not causing no one no grief.
I think that's kind of my thing with Graff, man. It's like...
They're more of a guard than a ticket inspector.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, that's the way I see it. He's a guard. He's there to make sure everything's fine on the train.
Yeah.
His eyes.
Yeah.
Yeah. His eyes with a phone in his hand.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
That's all
they are. Don't want no trouble neither, do they, really?
Of course they don't. What are they gaining out of giving someone a penalty fare? They're true. Still getting paid their wages, so why do they want the grief? As long as you're being all right with them, they'll be all right with you.
True.
Walk up to the bar, excuse me, I ain't got a ticket, bang, they open the gate.
Yeah, it's true.
I don't want to hot too many of them up, but yeah. A lot of them, you know, you be nice and polite.
And nice polite.
They let you go. If you try to force your way through, they're going to grab hold of you and try and hold you.
And it's a whole different conversation, isn't it?
There you go. And it's all for the same outcome, you getting out of the station.
Yeah. Yeah, sometimes it's all a bit premature. You get yourself into a whirl of trouble and intensity when that's not actually your agenda. You kind of got to deflect that.
Yeah, all you want to do is get out of the station, so you're talking about a little £2 fare, but yeah, the man's put his hands on you, you've put your hands on him, next thing, you're in jail for 6 months.
Because
of a £2 fare?
Yeah, yeah.
Again, you've got to think about what you're doing before you do it.
Mm. It's one of those kind of lifestyle consequences, isn't it? Where sometimes that instinct and that behaviour, it's amplified into other areas of your walk, and that's where the problems lie, because you'll get done for something that actually has nothing to do with what your agenda is.
What your aims are. No, yeah, that's exactly it. That is exactly it. It's like you're getting done for burglary because you're on the roof doing a rooftop. And then you have to hold your hands up and say, no, I weren't burglaring it, I'm doing some graph. And then, you know, You've glassed yourself up. Like, yeah. Who on earth does that? You just got to roll with it because there ain't going to be no evidence of you doing burglary. So you just say no comment, like.
Yeah, yeah.
Or bullshit them are. Some geezers pulled up next to me with a gun and I had to run and this is where I've ended up. I don't know where I am. Like, no, I don't know. Bullshit them, you know what I mean?
No, I appreciate what you're saying. Yeah, I'm with you.
Yeah, it's... You can get nicked for anything from doing anything. Anything can happen. Even the most innocent person could... Someone could hit them or something. They could be angry. Just give them a slap. Furthermore, even push someone over. And they hurt their sort of bang, you're in prison.
Oh, bro, coffee at the moment. So, you get fined for a coffee walking around, you know.
What's that?
You get fined for a coffee walking around at the moment with all the restrictions, don't you?
Walking around with a coffee?
Yeah.
Oh, not me.
Hey, you want a beer?
Yeah. No, I love a coffee. I do.
But you know what I mean? Like, they're being really... You know, fucking...
I think they're picking on certain people again, yeah? Because they see a certain person walk along the road, say nothing to them, and then see the next person, bang, they want to jump on you.
Yeah.
So, I guess it's all prejudiced anyway.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
You know, it's very hard to explain.
It is.
You know, all right, look, no barbecues on allowed on the common, and then you get the posh lot with their big gazebo and their barbecue.
And they're
please
all right.
Don't say nothing to them. You turn up with your little disposable. Yeah, you've got a brick under it, you're not burning the grass and all of that. But yet they're on the phone. Oh, they're having a barbecue. This is what I mean, a society of moaners. Why not let us have our fun? You know?
I agree.
But you do get people, they leave a mess and all that shit. Yeah. And it ruins, again, touching on the legal wall sort of thing.
Yeah.
The area around it's going to get mashed up. It just goes hand in hand.
Yeah.
And then obviously you're going to have your moment. Oh, it's because of that place down there.
Oh, and then that becomes the problem. That becomes the primary problem.
But it's always happened on your shop shutters. You've just now got something to blame.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, you've got something to moan about to someone.
Yeah, yeah.
People get off on it. Why?
Yeah, yeah. It's true. Because graffiti is well documented as being like a historical thing throughout time. Like, the things that we're talking about now, well, back in the day, still apply to now. But what makes the difference is feel like they've got a platform to complain about.
Yeah, look, you've got your hieroglyphics and all. Come on, this is, people have been writing on walls for years. What's changed? What? Because I'm writing, not my name, but my nickname. Well, what's any different than a picture on the wall then? You know? Or my man sprayed a goldfish on the wall. Oh, people like that because they know what goldfish... Well, you know what letters are. What? So, I like that word. Ooh.
Yeah.
You know, what's one person likes, someone else don't like.
It's I think that's what
everything.
It is.
It's choice.
It's subjective, isn't it?
It's your freedom of choice.
Yeah.
I don't like everything I see, but I like what it is.
You appreciate the labour.
They've had to go out and do that work. Yeah. So whether it's... good, rubbish, whatever, it don't matter. They've put that effort into doing that. You know, they get up everywhere. Yeah, that's what the graphing is. It's not about how good you are, it's about how up you are.
I think for
people... Or it's the both of them aspects.
You're right. I think for people like me, fans of the culture and the average Joe on the street, I think they're more intrigued about how much dedication for no money... For the risk factor.
This is what I'm saying. You've got to appreciate it, even if it ain't all that, you know.
Crazy risk factor.
Everyone ain't all that when they started. Come on, you know what I mean? You look at some of the stuff, like, you thought it was the bollocks then, and you look at it now, you go, what the fuck was I thinking? And all of us started like that. So you have to look on it and say, well, you've got to start somewhere. I like the way they're getting reaches there. I like what they're doing there. You know, you might not like their graph, but... I like the movement, what they're doing.
The movement, yeah. Because it is a movement, isn't it?
Yeah, if everyone stopped and weren't doing it, it'd just be dead, wouldn't it? So,
yeah,
you know.
It finds its way, though. It comes in...
What happens is you end up getting a few new heads, and then the old heads are like, right, fuck that, I'm getting back out there. And then you have you have these waves.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, you obviously, you find in the winter it gets darker earlier, so you'll find... A lot more gets done. It's dark at 4 or 5 o'clock.
People
are out there painting, you know, them extra hours. That's a lot of painting time. Losing myself.
See, this is what the podcast does here. Yeah, I mean.
It's just mask, mate. I can't breathe.
Well, listen, it's been an absolute pleasure. We will not be letting you hold your breath for too long. Are you all right? Come on.
That's what
it's
the
all it's all anarchy, isn't it?
You're getting a man moist, isn't it? Right. Until next time, I suppose.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I'll have some better stories next time.
Oh, come
I know what to expect.
Stories galore, man. Come on.
Yeah, I've got loads, but too many to even touch on and be here all day.
Yeah, have you enjoyed it?
Yeah, it's been cool.
We'll get a part two on, shall we?
Yeah. Hopefully when the lockdown's done and we can,
Do properly, have a
little bit of a party and that.
Yeah, oh, mate. Rolling times, man, roll them on. Bubba, thank you so much for passing through.
Cool, lovely.
We'll allow your breath. You can breathe easy. Knowing that you've struck gold, man. Killer Keller Podcast, big shout out to all the regulars. Yeah, it's part one, we're getting to part two another time, all right? No games, all right? Sharing is caring. Big shout out to Vods.
Laters.
Stay lucky, people. Peace.